good to see everybody out this morning, and glad that we can be out this morning, because there's still a lot of people that can't be, so we ought to be thankful for that. Got a couple of announcements, and then we'll go over the prayer list. Announcement, the Gladys True visitation here at 2 to 4 and service at 4 this afternoon. And then the golden offering and state's missions. That's what that's for. Okay, let me read over the prayer list we've got and see if we've got anybody to add. Lloyd Wright, Earl Wright, Stephen Harrison, Leah Dotson, Tina Peake, his mother, Tina Peake's mother, Ray Fugit, who is improving, Jerry Landon Good, Brother Harold's friend Herbert Tinkerly, Gladys True family, Jamie Jones, Jimmy Thorpe, Glenn Miles, Earlene Houston's granddaughter Nicole, family of Cherie Eastep, Sharon Lindsay's parents, Kelsey Goins, Melissa Goins' mother, who's having surgery this week, Tina Clark, Beth Fisher's dad, Dicey Brown's parents, Unspoken, and of course the praise for being back at church, and Courtney Pensy and baby Maya. Do we have anybody else to add to the list?
Tim, I need to add Byron Rose.
Byron Rose?
Yes, he's having prostate cancer surgery this week.
Okay.
Let's keep Pam's brother Billy on there.
Okay. Anybody else?
Put both my brothers, Avery and Johnny, on there. Johnny had some tests ran, waiting on results, and Avery had have 2 pints of blood this week, so just put both of them on there, please.
Okay. Anybody else?
Put Anna Laura Grindle. That's Nola's youngest daughter. She's having a shoulder replacement on Wednesday.
Grindle?
Uh-huh.
Okay. Anybody else?
Did we have Francis' son?
Yeah, Stephen Harrison. Okay. Yeah, I called him. Okay. Anyone else? If not, Wilson, will you open some prayer there?
Our dear Christian Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, Father, for another day. Father, you give us, O Lord, the chance to be back in our house, Father. Just be the one that's on our prayer list, Father. Just touch them, O Lord, because, Father, you're in a great position, O Lord, Father. Just be with the service, O Lord, Father. Just help us all, Father, for all we ask in thy name. Amen.
Do we have any scripture reading today?
Thank you.
It is good to see you this morning. It's good to be back in God's house. It's good to be able to look out and speak to living people other than Bill. We've been doing this for a while, just the two of us, but it's time. This morning you probably found in your seat since you came in information about the golden offering, that is your state mission offering. As you look down through the list, it'll tell you about where that's used and the different things that Tennessee's doing to reach the people here. Lottie and Annie, Lottie reaches out to the world, Annie across the U.S., but this one is the Tennessee one. So let's be thinking about it, praying about it, and take that home and read it and just see what you're doing as part of state. This morning, I want us to think and look for a few minutes at the 30th Psalm. And this is one of the Psalms written by David. And as you look at it and begin to, before you read it, your Bible may have a little preface across the top. If it does, it probably says something like Psalm of the Dedication. Some say the dedication of the house. What this is, it was the Hebrew culture. Then when they got a new house, they took time to gather and dedicate it to the Lord. They felt like it was important that that house was dedicated and that they had invited God to be a part of who they were and what was going on there. So in reality, this became their house, but God's house also. When David was, at this time, was just finishing his house. It calls it a house of cedar in some places. It was his house or palace that he had built. David had always wanted to build a temple for God, a special place. That was his goal. But early on, God told him, David, you can't do that because you have too much blood on your hands. You were put here to bring together the nation. And he told him, said, your son will be the one that gets to actually build the house and put it together. He will be the one about that. David was upset, but he accepted that. And so he writes this psalm as a dedication psalm for his house. And as you look at it and you read through it, you'll see how much it speaks to us in our lives today. How we're to relate to the Heavenly Father. How we're to understand and speak to Him what we're to do. So as we look at it, let's think along with David and see what he's talking about. I'm going to read this particular psalm in sections instead of reading the whole thing as we look at it. Beginning with the first three verses. I will extol thee, O Lord, for thou hast lifted me up, and thou hast made my foes to rejoice over me. O Lord my God, I cry unto thee, and thou hast healed me. O Lord, thou hast brought up my soul from the grave. Thou hast kept me alive, that I should not go down to the pit. What's he doing? He begins by saying this. It's time for me to really work on my life. It's time for me to more or less take an inventory and see where I am and what you've done for me and what I need to do in my own life. He goes on to say, Lord, continually, I know you've cared for me in danger, in sickness. Possibly at times David had been very sick and God had reached out and taken care of him. He was in danger a lot. He got into a lot of situations. He said, you're my protection. You watch over me. 23rd Psalm, another one that David also wrote, he says, even if I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, that are with me. You're walking beside me. You're there. God, work on my life. I can just imagine as David sat down to pen the words to this particular psalm. He might have been thinking about one day as he walked out across the area to a small stream. And he looked around for five small, smooth stones that he needed for his slingshot. He was about to face the lion. And he knew the danger that was there. But he felt like God would take care of him and be with him. And so he walked out on that plain between two armies, and he looked up. And he saw a giant that some say was 8 feet, some say close to 9 feet. He towered above David. David was a young man. He was probably in his teens. He looked at him, and I'm sure in great fear he saw this one standing before him. But he believed God would take care of him. And he remembered it was God when he turned that stone loose that led it straight to the point. It says he was carrying a shield, he had on armor, he had on a helmet. There was one spot that he was very open to being hit. And God put that stone in that spot. David remembered. He remembered when he was honored by Saul, that Saul's honor stood, soon turned to jealousy. And he was after him. He said, I'm going to get him one way or another. He remembered Saul in his anger picking up a spear and throwing it at him and almost taking his life. He remembered again that God was there protecting him. He remembered those battles they went into with the Philistines and others surrounding him and how that God protected him was there. The king was expected to be out front with him. And so God had to put special protection to take care of David. He said, you've been there. You've been there with me. And he pauses and said, it's time for me now to work on my life. Lord, you protected me, but I haven't always been true. It's time for me to begin to work on my life. As I thought about this and what David was doing, it reminded me of something that I was doing this week. I have a small little desk at the house, and I have a tendency to pile up stuff on it. Now, I know you probably don't. You don't have a table or anything that you ever pile stuff on, do you? Any of them? Barbara, do you? Oh, I had one of my bosses in Mississippi that was, I'd go to his office and his desk was piled. There was no way he could ever find anything on it. It was just stacked, you know. No way. Well, I spent time going through and trying to sort and throw away. Throw it out the junk. The unused stuff that I've kept that I don't need on there, that I lay there and think, I'll look at that a little bit later. And I went through all of that junk just to throw it away. We need to take regular times in our lives to look at the junk that we've stored in there. We put a lot of junk in our lives. Junk that keeps us from walking with God. That's what David was talking about. Sometimes it's grudges. You see people and they've done something and think, you know, I'm not going to let that really bother me. And then the next time you say, I really would like to hit them. I'd like to do something to them. I'd like to get even. We have to get rid of grudges and throw them away. Because I learned a long time ago, you know what a grudge hurts? It hurts you. It doesn't hurt them. A lot of times, don't even know that you care now, but it hurts you down inside. David knew that. You got to get rid of the fears. You know, we all have fears. David had fears about what was taking place. He had a reason to have fears because a lot of things happened in his life. You go through and you look at it, and sometimes it's green. It's things I want that. You know, I just can't live without this. I want this. I want these things. We have to pitch them out and say, God, what really do I need? And what do I need to do with the blessings you give me? Sometimes it's just pure hate that we throw out. And I'm sure David dealt with that in his idea. And sometimes it's just useless stuff and ideas. Sometimes it's the things we read. Sometimes the things we watch. It's things when you say, is that really
doing me any good. Let me push it out of the way and forget about it. David had a lot to get rid of. And so I imagine if we look at ourselves, we do also. Remember, he's dedicating his house. That means dedicate all of it. That means getting rid of these things and pushing them out of the way. David was saying to God, Lord, you've kept me alive for a purpose. You have a purpose in doing this. What is it? He keeps talking about it. You've kept me alive, and you made sure you didn't send me down to the pit. He's talking about being gone, period. You've kept me for a purpose. What do you want me to do? Do you ever pause in your prayer time or in your thinking or in your study and say, God, what is my purpose? What am I doing here? What did you put me here for? So I was working on this sermon. I thought of a friend that I had one time. He was active in church. He and I did a lot of traveling together when we visited and things like that. And sometimes I just ask him, what is your real goal? What do you want to do in life? And he said, one thing. We were both a lot younger then. And he said, one thing, before I'm 40, I want to be a millionaire. It wasn't about what he wanted to do for God or anything. He wanted to be a millionaire. You know what? He made it. But at what cost? It cost him his family. It cost him so much of his happiness, of his thing, of he could have walked in and done so much. But he was willing to throw it away because of things. Of things. Did we do that? That's what David was talking about. Paul writes to the church of the Philippians in the third chapter, verses 13 and 14. It reads like this. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. This is the key verse. I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. What's he saying? This one thing I do. I dedicate my life totally to living for God and doing what he wants me to do. That's what David was trying to work out. He spent a lifetime doing it, trying to get there. And he had a lot of going back and not making it. I guess he was a lot like me and you. We have our goal. We set it up there. But a lot of times, we don't get there the way we want to and quit like we want to. In the next three or four verses, David is working on his relationship now with God. He was really working on his life, and now he looks at it and said, this relationship, God, I want to work on this. He said, pull me out of the net. Oh, excuse me, about a jump of verse. Say unto the Lord, O ye saints of his, and give thanks at the remembrance of his holiness. For his anger endureth but for a moment. In his favor is life. And this is part of the verse. This is what got me started in this as we're looking at it. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. We can be all upset. We can be all bothered. Everything can really be bad. But joy comes in the morning. It's a new day that God has given us to make a difference. He goes on to say, in my prosperity, I said, I shall never be moved. David was understanding something as he was dedicating and writing about his house. That he actually was dealing with two houses. He was dealing with the physical house he lived in. But he was dealing with a personal house. Remember what the scripture tells us? In the New Testament, when the Holy Spirit comes in, he moves into your house. Your body becomes the temple that's there. But that wasn't a concept that was just known in the New Testament. Even in the Old Testament, as you get to looking at it and reading back, it talks about, the Old Testament men start talking about God actually, in us moving in together in Psalm 91, which is one of the Psalms of Moses and the prayer that Moses gave, he said, "Thou hast been my dwelling place for all generations." I'm with you there. I've been with you, my dwelling place. Moses could sure say that, because Moses had a long walk with God. And he had to have God personally there with him, or he would have gotten so sick of the children of Israel as he was trying to move, he'd given up on them. He'd have walked away from them. But he walked with God. And he said, you've been my dwelling place. You've kept me there. You know what I'm doing. David was seeing how important it was to walk with God in what he did. He goes on as he talks in the scripture. He says, God, sometimes you get upset with us. I think a better terminology would be, you get disappointed with us. You look at what we do. You bless us. You give us opportunity. And we fall down with it. We don't care for it. And so he's saying, Lord, you know, you may be disappointed, upset, but you forgive. You forgive us and all of that. And he goes on then with the scripture there. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. A new day. David understood. And he had his share of heartache. He certainly had. He had Absalom, his son, who in treachery decided he was going to take the throne. He was going to dispose his own father, and he was going to take over. He was going to be in control. And he went through the battle that they faced with that. Some even say that this house that God was dedicating, that Absalom ran him out of it for a time. He didn't even have his own palace that was there, that Absalom had scared him to that point. He understood that. And then Absalom, who was a son he dearly loved, he realized and saw his death because of his treachery there. He had to deal with that. He dealt with the death of a son by his wife that he had taken very unfairly and from her husband. And this child died. And he weeps and he goes in and he talks to God about that. And how hard it was for him to accept the loss of that son. He remembered the dark days of Saul. When he was on his on the run, when he went in and ate the showbread that was there that only the priest was supposed to eat because he was hungry and running from God and running from Saul. And he was looking for God's protection. He ran to the cave when Saul was there close by him, that close to him. He remembered all that. But he knew something else. Always a new day came. Joy came. In our deepest times of distress, in our deepest hurts, a new day comes. God said, have you been there when all seems to fall apart? When you say, how can I face the future? And then you stop and you wait and you look for that new day. God called yesterday afternoon from a lady that was in church with. I was her minister of education nearly 40 years ago. And she was calling. I got a call one day from my former secretary. And she said, can I give this lady your number? And I said, well, sure. And her husband recently had passed away. And she was trying to deal with it. And she said, Jim, said, you see, I'm going back to my old ministers. I just needed to talk. And as she talked, she shared the hurt that had come from this. And she says, what carries me through is early in the morning, when morning comes, it's hard for me because that was always a special time that we had together. But so I wanted to get up and talk to God. He makes all the difference in the world. Joy comes in the morning with a new He goes on in verses 6 through 10, and he says, always look for the positive. And really, 6 goes with both of those, but picking up 7. Lord, by the favor that has made my mountain to, made my mountain to stand on, that has hid thy face, and I was troubled. I cried to thee, O Lord, and unto the Lord I made supplication. What profit is there in my blood when I go down to the pit? Shall the dust praise thee? Shall it declare thy truth? Hear, O Lord, and have mercy upon me. Lord, be thou my helper. What's he talking about? He says in that 6th verse, yeah, I would get so excited when you bless me. And in my prosperity, I said, I'll never be moved. I'm here. I made it. He goes on in that next verse, said, I felt like a mountain. I felt like I stood out because of God's blessings on me. And I took my stand, and you know what he forgot? He forgot why he was there. He forgot that it was God was blessing him, and that it was not him doing it himself. He said, I forget. And all of it would fall apart around me. In 2 Samuel, the 7th chapter, you find God and David talking. God, this is in a different portion of Scripture, but when he just moved in to this new house, he was pleased with what he had. He was so excited about it, but he still wanted God to have the house of his own. And instead of there, he says, God, this is what I want to build. And God made a statement to him. He said, no, David, you won't do that. You see, I've had a house all along. From the time that the children of Israel came out of Egypt, I've had a house that was a tent. And I was completely satisfied with that. They moved it around. And it was there that they'd come to meet me, and we had talked. And that was sufficient for what I wanted to do. Because all I need of people were willing to come and meet with me and gather with me there. He said, one day I'll allow them to build a house, but in Peter's son that does that, it won't be me. David had all the success of building a nation. He had brought the children of Israel together. He built them into a powerful force, into a nation, a country. They had taken the land, they had done all these things. And here the thing that he wanted to do most, God says to him, no, you're not going to do that. He was greatly upset, but he goes on to say, but even in my sadness, you're able to turn to joy. You've helped me to see the future of what you do with me and what you'll do in the future of what's to come. That's what God does for us. That's what he helps us to do as we look to the positive. Last week I picked up a little book that I read. It was written by Dale Evans, and it was listed as her diary of the way she and God had dealt in a portion of time in her life. If you ever were fans of Roy Rogers and Dale Evans, number one cares to be pretty old at the second. They were quite fun to watch as they were in the movies and then on the TV for a long time. But Roy and Dale, after they married, had a child by the name of Robin. Robin was a Down syndrome baby. She was born, lived for about 2 years. As Dale described her, always happy, always a smile on her face. But what Dale and Roy found out was that during this time of dealing with that child, they had been nominal Christians. But they became totally dedicated in their walk. They began to understand what God can do within their life, the difference that he can make when he picks you up. He puts his arms around you, and she shares than in all the negative that came, could have been there, that they found positive. They became advocates for these children. And across the world, they lifted them up. And they helped people see the need that was there and what could be done and what could happen. And in the process, they adopted other children to take care of and to be with them. In the darkest times, she looked for the positive and found it. And that positive was in dark. David completes his song saying, "I will be thankful forever," verse 12, "to the end that my glory may see, praise to thee, and not be silent. O Lord my God, I give thanks unto thee." And the verse before it, "Thou hast turned from me my mourning into dancing. Thou hast put off my sackcloth and girded me with gladness." He says, "In all the things that I've dealt with, I have found peace. I found happiness. You've turned my life around in all that I do. And you helped make me into what you want me to be." He began to understand what living was all about. As he dedicated his house, he thought of new hope. And he said, "God, I'm dedicating me. I'm going to do what you want me to do and make a difference in the world which in I found." He had understood what Paul had been saying in that verse, a couple of verses we read a few moments ago. This one thing, I forget everything else. God, I'm going to put you first in my life. So what are they saying? First, one thing I do, I'm always looking to God. When anything goes wrong, I'm going to look to God. I'm not going to try to take it on myself. I'm not going to go out and talk to everybody around and say, "What can I do?" I'm going to first of all go to God and say, "God, what's going on and what can I do to make a difference?" Second thing they learned and wanted to do, I'm going to have a purpose in my life, a supreme work. God, I'm going to make sure that I'm doing something that's worth what I'm giving my life to. Do you ever look around you and see people that seemingly have all of this success and you wonder, what in the world have they done to make a difference in God's kingdom? What have they done for Him? You can make all the money in the world and it's not worth anything if you don't have a purpose of living for God. Because ultimately, that's your goal, is to be there. I'd hate to know that I put all my efforts into what I was doing here and missed the real purpose of life and the purpose of understanding and accepting Christ as our Lord and Savior. And then the third thing that they learned, follow totally His lead. Follow His lead. If you look at Paul's life, if you look at David's life, it was a lifetime struggle for both of them. David would go forward and slide back some, go forward and slide back some. But ultimately, he knew what he was out from him. He knew God was to be his goal. Paul was doing the same thing. He talks about it. He says, "You know, I don't always do what God wants me to do. Sometimes I more or less royally mess up. But I keep out in front of me the concept of God." David in his walk concludes the 23rd Psalm with what he found out. He said, "Ultimately, my goal is to live in the house of the Lord of prayer." That's what I'm working for. That's what I'm doing. I believe and hope that's your goal this morning, that you're thinking about God's house and living in His house forever. That's what we're prepared for. We live here to the best of our ability in our walk with Him. So we can understand that. And it will be so special to us if you read and intensely study the Scripture about what Jesus is saying. Ultimately, I think what you're seeing in there is that what are the rewards of heaven? The rewards of heaven are being Jesus, to be there with him throughout eternity. And the ones that are going to be the most excited and happy there are the ones that have done the best here and given their best. Because in our love for him, all of what Paul is talking about in sanctification is that we grow all of our lives getting ready for heaven so that we can enjoy, appreciate, and understand the blessings he's given us. Thankful for David taking time to write and remind us it's our house that we need to dedicate to God. Our physical house, our personal house, all of that, we should let God live in and be a part of. Let's pray together. Father, as we come this morning, I come thanking you for sending men like David to write your message to us. And Father, how thankful we are that here in the middle of the book of Psalms, that you've given us a special thought. A thought about our house and what we're to do. I pray this week we take time, clean it out, throw away the junk, get you in closer, and learn how to walk and live with you. Bless us during this time of invitation. Be with us and touch the lives that need to be touched, we pray. In Christ's name, amen. We're going to have our time now of dedication. And Connie will be playing. I invite you, if you would like to stand, because this will be our closing time. Stand for our time of invitation. I surrender all. That's what God says to us. Give me your life and let me use it the way I want to. Thank you for being here this morning. Glad to see all of you. It's so good to be back in God's house. As we close this morning, Phil, would you do our closing prayer?
Amen. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, for this time together. We thank you for the message today, Lord. We ask you, Lord, to be with us this week as we continue to build our house and as we continue to move, Lord, towards the goal, towards the mark, and toward the purpose of which you gave to each and every one of us, that we all have a different purpose sometimes in what it is that we have to do. Pray to make it clear to each of us, and pray, Lord, you'd open opportunities for us to further the kingdom this week. For it's in Christ Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Thank you.